have a great lesson. I think it's the conclusion of this particular quarter. We're going to end with the way, the truth, and the life, as Jesus has shown to us. And we that have been in Scripture for a long time have a good understanding and know that the only way to the Father is having faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Making that confession with your mouth, but you believe it in your heart. And that says, according to Romans, with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. And so we have salvation, and we see that Jesus is doing a preparation work. He says he had some work to do after he left. He had some preparation to do. What is he preparing? Afterlife, where will we find ourselves in the afterlife? The Bible gives some insights as to where you can probably find yourself in the afterlife. Faith, of course, gets us into salvation, but the Bible has some insights into some things that's going to happen that we have no idea, we don't know, we just got to see. But let's see, let's go with the first part of our lesson. The only way to God, the only way to God, is to have faith in Jesus Christ. And that's brought out many times in Scripture. This lesson background, Jesus is saying, I'm going to prepare something for you. I got something to prepare for you. As we look in the book of St. John, running through the 12th chapter of St. John, let's run through that right quick. See some of the happenings that was going on. We see as of last week, as we set the stage, that Jesus was telling, and that was in St. John 11, but we'll see that he in 12, in St. John 12, he had just come through Bethany and he healed his friend. Am I right? Yeah, Matthew 12 and chapter 1. 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus, which had been dead, he raised him. So that's Lazarus' territory. Lazarus has been around there. They made him supper. Martha served. But Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. They took bread and all that kind of stuff that was going on. And verse 23 of that 12th chapter, Jesus answered them and said, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily I say unto you, except a corn of wheat shall fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone, but if it die, it bringeth forth fruit." So Jesus is giving them information, but they're not too much catching on as to what are you talking about. And verse 27, Jesus is saying, "My soul is troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I into the world." So for this cause, he's in the world, and he's talking about his dying, his departure. Disciples not quite clued in. What are you talking about, the departure? What's all that about? So, verse 28, "Father, glorify thy name." And we hear some, verse 28, some great things there. Then came a voice from where? Heaven. So verse 31, "Judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out." But how can the prince of this world be cast out except there is someone powerful than him? There was no one powerful than the little G-O-D on this earth walking except for one man. That was the man of Jesus, who was here as a man, able to do that. You and I, we were just pretty much in a bad shape because we couldn't deal with the prince of this world. Is that what it says there? The prince of this world is going to be cast out, going to take his authority, going to take his power out of this world. But, so Jesus is saying that he's giving them a clue, I got to be the one to do that. And if I don't do it, it won't get done. And he is the prince of this world. And the prince of this world is governing hard taskmasters, enslaving people right now that do not have the faith that you and I have in Jesus Christ. He is dominating them to the degree, steal, kill, and destroy, and all the way to the grave. That's what he's all about. Jesus says, I got to destroy that. Verse 32, someone read that if you will, please. Of 12 chapter.
And if I be lifted up from the earth, draw all men unto me.
Okay, verse 33.
This he said signifying what death he should die.
Okay, all right. Verse 34 says, he says, the Son of Man must be lifted up. And who is this Son of Man? So this Son of Man, when he says lifted up, he must be made a sacrifice. He's got to be a sacrifice. All right. So that's what's going on with chapter 12. Verse 45 of chapter 12. He that seeth me does what? See him that sent me. And we're going to see some, everything I'm reading to you, some of this stuff is going to become a question in the next chapter. Because Thomas is going to ask him, who are you? Who really are you? And here we're going to jump ahead and go ahead and get that answer. Because Thomas is going to ask that question. And Jesus, he that seeth me, he told him before. And a little while later, Thomas asked, who are you? Who really are you? And Jesus already told him, if you see me, you have seen the Father. I am the Father. That's what he was. He's God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Ghost. And as he walked with them, just operating as a man, they saw his miracles, but they didn't catch too much of his deity. And who are you? He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said that many times the Father and I are one. We work together. I am. But they saw him as a man. And he said, I'm here as a man, and I recognize the prince of this world is operating and ruling this world. Remember we said, there's only two men that came into the world free of sin. First Adam, the Adam that we study about in Genesis, and Jesus himself is the second Adam. What did we know that's unique about them? They both had power and dominion over anything on this earth. But Jesus is saying, my followers, they don't have dominion over the prince. The rest, they don't have dominion. They can't rule. They can't dominate like they were created to be because of the prince of this world. And more than that, because Adam sold out to him. So that's why. Now, so Jesus said, you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Verse 48, he that rejected me and received not my words, had one that adjudge him. The word that I have spoken, the same judge him in the last day. Okay, I've not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me commandment, what I should say, what I should speak. All right, and we're going to jump to chapter 13, talk about what's happening in there. Let's see here. Let's look at verses 17. If you know these, we'll talk about these things. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. I speak not of you all, I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled, he that eateth bread with me, I got a friend sitting here at the table who's going to become my enemy. He says, I got a friend. They said, wait, we're all close. We're all buddy buddies. But he's sitting down. And he says, I got someone here at the table who's going to rise up against me. This close-knit bunch is going to rise up against me. Someone is going to come go against me. Maybe, no, man, we put you all away. He says, no, someone's against me. So, and then he says, verse 19, I tell you before it come, that when it comes to pass, when it does happen, that you might even have a deeper faith that I am he who that I'm preaching about. So, now, we're just going to keep on running. We're going to run over to verse 30-something over here in this 13th chapter. Let's see. Verse 34, love one another. You keep loving one another. And Peter said in verse 36 in that 13th chapter, Lord, where are you going? Jesus says, where I go, you can't follow me when? Now. Now. See, where I am getting ready to go, you can't follow me now. Yeah. Where are you going? Anywhere on the earth will follow you. We'll be with you anywhere you go. We're your boys. Remember you picked us up? You recruited us. We're your home team. And you told us to keep up with you. Now you're telling us all of a sudden you're going somewhere we can't go with you. What are you talking about? So that kind of confused them, messing them up, messing with their head. Peter says, wait a minute. And Jesus says, but where I go, you can't follow me when? Now. But you'll follow me later. That's blue circuits. They didn't know what was talking about. What's verse 37 say?
Peter said to him, Lord, why cannot I follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake.
Yeah. Jesus said,
wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice.
Amen. You be the first one to deny me. I'm ready to follow you. I'm ready to give my life. No, you're weak. You can't go the distance. Oh, can't go the distance. That's the question for us today. Can we go the distance? What is the distance? I don't know. I can't see up in there. But can you go the distance from here on, circumstance, situation, stuff going on? Can you go the distance so where you can follow, be with me where I'm going to prepare a place for you? There's some things come up in people's lives down here on earth. Completely knocks my game. Through it being saved, through the church, through it all, y'all. Through. Didn't work out. Gave my offering still poor. Through. You know, all whatever the situation may be, people will not go the distance. I can't follow you that far. All right. Now we're going to jump into where we are today in our lesson. He says there right off the bat. So Peter is troubled. I asked the question, what event are we talking about in John 14 and 1? What would you call that event? We're wasting John's film. With no audio on it. What is that even? St. John 14 and 1. What's it, St. John 14 and 2?
I give up. To the memory. How to go to heaven.
He has to go to heaven. Is there another event? Brother Travis? That's real. Huh?
Maybe he's talking about the afterlife.
Getting there? Getting there? Jump too far. Here we go. Don't be troubled. Don't let your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. Now, because before this event that I'm talking about, let not your heart be troubled. He's worried. Jesus is concerned about his followers. Because if he's telling you, don't worry, don't let anxiety and stress take you out, he's anticipating, or he knows that there's going to be some time that it's going to be challenging more than you have ever faced before. Some stuff. How many went to the military? Your folks saw you off. Went to college, they saw you off. You was confident, you going, but they was kind of shaky with you leaving. Because we're just not sure, you know, you're gonna be all right. We're gonna be. What is it? So when Jesus is leaving here, he is saying he knows that if I step out of the world, the prince of who darkness left behind, he's gonna put the pressure on you. Because he knows I'm not here to help you out. He's gonna put it on you. He's gonna try to put it on you. Now we're in church today is in a better position than they are. When he made this statement to them, because they have absolutely become weak. Mm-hmm. They can't do nothing. They can't heal nobody. They can't raise nobody from the dead like they saw me over there next to me. They can't do nothing. Whoa, where you going? What? How come we can't follow you? What's up? Let not your heart be troubled. Now that is a twofold deal, because it flows over into us. The devil is going, is things getting better or worse these days? Down here on the earth. It ain't getting pretty good. You can marry this, you know, same sex partner, that's all right. Things is getting good. It's flowing right along. Everybody got civil rights. You know, and there's a whole bunch of stuff getting worse. And it's going to press us as believers. And he's telling us as well, let not your heart be troubled, because there's going to be some squeeze that's coming on. Even there, immediately, there was some immediate squeeze right around the corner. But he told them, don't let your heart be troubled. Keep your faith. Keep your faith in God. How do I do that? Keep your faith in me. Remember what I told you. Remember what I showed you. Remember all I did. Because I'm getting out of here. I got to go. You got to stay behind. And the yogurt's going to be hitting the fan left and right. But keep the faith. He told me not to worry. I mean, don't get too uptight. Then he came right back and said, In my father's house are many mansions. Wow, I don't have any idea what a mansion, and I got somewhere, but I don't know. What does a mansion look like back in that day? But it was a good dwelling place, I can tell you that. So in my father's house, he has a lot of good safety spots. He's got all the comforts you want and all that.
And, a lot of room.
Yeah, that's it. Some good places in my father's house. If it wasn't so, I wouldn't tell you. So he's telling you, there's a lot of good provisions in my father's house. Okay, that's good to hear. What next? I'm going to do what? Prepare a place for you. Now, that's the key right there, a key. I'm going to prepare. You mean heaven ain't ready for me yet? What you gotta do to get heaven ready for me? For my arrival. What do you gotta be doing? Well, I gotta go up there, and he says, so Jesus right now is in our way. Then he was leaving to do preparation work for you and I to get into the Father's house. Why don't you do it down here while you're on earth? You've got to be in heaven to get it done. Got to be up there to do it. Can't do it down here. There's some preparation in a place that I'm going to. Got to prepare. Now, this is getting deep as I speak. You and I, back then, could not get into heaven because some work had not taken place yet. There was a reality of afterlife. There was life under the ground. Activity under the ground. There's activity on the earth. There's activity in the atmosphere where the airplanes fly. There's activity up where the astronauts go. And when we're getting farther and farther out here, you get your telescope, keep looking, there's some stuff up there and out there. And man, Earth was prepared for man. That's the best we got, Earth. But there's another place for you can't go there yet because it's not prepared for you. All right? What's some of the work Jesus had to do? He had to first down the cross, go down into the afterlife under the earth, suffer torment down there, rise up again. That's why it says over there in Ephesians, he first went to hell and suffered, and then he rose again. And he went farther and farther on out there. It says, I'm going to put now. When he rose up again, he's preparing a place for us. But there's still an event that this is pointing to. It's pointing to the rapture. The rapture, without him making preparation, if he just comes and says, let's go. Where are we going? Going to my, what? It's not that. Heaven's not ready. Where do I have a place? Where are you going? See, so he gives you a clue. There's going to be a place for you. You got an address in heaven, different from mine. My address is Al lives over there, Williams is over here, and he turned me into heaven. That's the spot. That's where they want to be. Mm-hmm. We can't fathom that, but that's what he says. I'm going to prepare a place for you. All right, then I go to prepare it. I got to go get it ready. And if I go and prepare a place for you. He says, I'm going to do what?
Come again.
That's called the what? We know what that's the.
Right here.
I'm going to come again. I'm going to come back to get you. Jesus says, when I show up again, we're going. I'm coming again. I got to prepare it for you. I got to prepare it. When I show up, we're going. Evidently, it's not prepared yet. Not ready. Heaven's not ready for you to go there. Some of us are doing our best to get there. How to get into the afterlife or what have you. But your time to get there is when Jesus shows up. It's ready. Here we go. What? I go and I will come again and receive you unto myself. Because I'm going to take you and show you how to get there. Where I am, you can come to me. Where I've been, I'm going to show you how to get there. As he's talking to his disciples, place not ready.
The scripture that you refer to in Ephesians is 4:19.
Mm-hmm.
Now that he ascended,
mm-hmm.
what is it that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things.
He had to first, I gotta finish my work, and you guys cannot participate with me in this work. I gotta go get it done. By myself, I can't just go straight to heaven from where I left from. I got to go down into the deep parts of the earth, suffer down there. I got to be risen again, resurrected again. And then I got to go show myself to my Father. And he's saying, now, all of that is making preparation work for you and I to get into heaven. And even after he finished that, there's more work that he's doing up there to get us in there. So it's nothing that you can do down here to prepare that place. There are some things that, don't get me wrong, there's some things that you can do to qualify for your mansion. There's some things that you can do down here that can qualify you for you. Not qualify this, do I deserve eternal life, but do I deserve a Bentley or a Volkswagen? You know, you was just an old nominal Christian, and you was always just marginal at best, and you got eternal life. Now we're going to give you, here you get to pull this wagon. This is your spot. This is your place. Because we see, according to Paul's revelation, there are some qualifying things that you're doing down here, even though you don't know it, you're just doing it, just living a life. It gets you to a certain level up in heaven, in the afterlife, that you and I can't even fathom. There's going to be some people, apostles, elders, people like that, pastors, evangelists, soul winners, all those kind of people, prayer warriors. They get paid. Oh, that's wow. Yeah, see, you did all that praying and all that stuff down there on earth, and you didn't pay for it, nothing like that. You didn't take no credit for it. But your Father saw it, it's rewarded. This is what you get. But I got to prepare. It's got to be prepared for you. He's preparing you, building your spot for you right now. Your spot for you right now. Yeah. That's why he says, I got to prepare it for you. First preparation for you, he's got to die for you. He's got to die. Now he's keeping you in the game, too. How are you keeping me in the game? Making intercession. I'm praying. He's up there praying at the right hand of the Father, praying for you every day because he knows he's gone and the little prince down here going for the squeeze. And somewhere he says, the devil, he wants to shift you like wheat. He wants to knock you out. knock you out of the game. See, if you can't go the distance. Why? Because the little prince down here is foolish. So that's why he said, don't be troubled. Don't get chased out of the game. Let not your heart be troubled. I left, but I'm taking care of business. Putting it today's turn. Okay. All right, now here we go. Where do I go? Verse 4, you know. And the way you know. At the same time, somebody said, no. So who said verse 5? Thomas. Thomas is known for what characteristic? He's a doubter. You got to prove it to him. I'm a doubter, man. I mean, I got the feel, see, smell, touch. for I believe anything. That's Thomas. Anybody here like that? I got to see it first. I don't trust nobody's word. I got to see it, feel it, touch it. I got to taste it. It's got to appeal to my senses. If I can't see it, can't smell it, can't taste it, can't touch it, it ain't real.
It's got to make sense to
me. It got to make sense. That's my sensual man, my mentality. So, Lord, so this is what Thomas is saying. I got all of that other stuff. Lord, we know not what? Where you going? Well, I can't figure that out. So I can't have no faith in that. Can't figure that out. How can we know the ways? And Jesus said unto him, I am the truth and the light. No man come to the Father but by me. So Thomas, evidently, you're not what? Acquainted enough with me. You don't know me. How many sinners hit it daily? I don't know them. They don't know me. They don't know each other. And Jesus said, I've been with you, Thomas. I chose you to follow me and be my recruit. And Jesus is in a sense saying, yeah, I guess you don't know me. What do you mean, don't know me? Well, you saw me raise Lazarus. You saw me heal the sick, feed the thousands with the bread and the fish, and turn the water into wine. I guess you just don't know me, Thomas. Thomas, I guess you just don't know me. We can't follow you, Jesus, if we don't know where you're going. Jesus said, I guess you just don't know me. How can we get to heaven, Jesus? Jesus said, I done told you so many times. I guess you just don't know me. Oh, wow. Well, so if you had known me, you should have known my Father and what? Also, if you had known me, but you didn't get to really know me, and I ain't got time to get reacquainted with you. Now, so from now on, you'll know him. They can't figure this out. They can't figure this out. We're going to know him and have what? Seen him. How have we seen him? We ain't seen God. The Father, because it said somewhere in the Bible, let me see here, I think it's going to be John 1:18. Yo, man, you can't say that we've seen God. John is known, each one of these disciples has their personalities, and they're going to say. But even after the fact, they're writing their books, this is what he said. John 1:18, no man has what? He's not you telling me that we see him. What are you talking about? He said, St. John 1:18, no man has seen God at any time. The only begotten of the Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he had what? Declared. I think it's going to be in Hebrews 1:3. You're going to see also something about that when you sing the Son, you sing the Father. It gives us a better description. Hebrews 1:3, if I'm going to say so. Hebrews 1:3. The Son, if you sing the Son, if you sing Jesus walking the earth, if you was acquainted with him, was close with him, that was the brightness of his glory. That was the express image of his person. Upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty. So I've never seen, someone says, I've never seen the majesty. Yeah, if you got a revelation of Jesus, if you know him, if you was acquainted with him, you've seen the Father. There's no difference. Yeah, you've seen him, but you've seen him. Haven't seen God, but you saw the Son. It's like looking in a mirror. I remember the first time you seen yourself in the mirror. You didn't have no idea what you're talking about. What is that? Someone's doing that, walk by a mirror and gain some weight. Where did that come from? That's what you look like. Look at you. Now you might have a mental deal about you, but look in the mirror. That's you. That's the express image. Exactly. Huh? Oh. What does Travis look like? Well, Travis gonna stand in front of the mirror. That's you. It's expressed. Exact. So when they saw Jesus, they saw the exact of the Father. That's the exact image. All right. Now, so he has to run through a few of his disciples here. And his disciples saw him in many different ways. Some of them get it like this, Matthew saw him as a king and a Messiah. So that's what Matthew is, a king, he's a Messiah. Mark saw him as a good servant, social worker, goes around doing good stuff for people. Good guy, you know, if you're hungry, he'll feed you. You're sick, he'll make you well. That's social, that's a good guy, man. Matthew saw him as a king and a Messiah. He's king, that's the Messiah we'll be looking for. That's the man. Mark said, yeah, he's doing a lot of this good stuff. If you run across you and you're in trouble, he'll come help you out. See here, Luke saw him as a perfect man. And then and John sees him as the Son of God. Look at John 12:44 right there. Look at him, Luke. And they're uptight simply because he's saying, I'm getting out of here and you can't come with me. Then we go to our lesson, but Philip, verse 8 says, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough. To show us the Father, that will be enough. Jesus said unto him, how long have I going to be? Philip, how long have we been together? So you can see Jesus' concern that these guys ain't got their faith level up where it need to be. You know, they done seen me do so much, and they just, I got to go. And now they, the questions that they're asking is not right. Guys, come on. Don't you believe yet? Don't you have it yet? We're going to get to find out this one gift that Jesus gives to us that answers, that enables us to have a lot of these questions answered. Now let's look at, verse 9. I have been so long with you and you got nerve to say, that's what he said. You got nerve? You don't know me? That's what he said. Philip? He's asked, Philip, you don't know me. Yeah. He says to Philip, he that has seen me has seen the Father. And he's asking Philip, how in the world, after all this time I've been with you can ask that question, that dumb question. He is so perturbed, Philip. And then he said, I got to go and leave him with the little prince of the world. They don't know nothing all this time. So now he's got that. He's going to ask Philip something. Verse 10, 14 and 10. I'm going to look at it in my Bible. It says here, he says, believest thou that I am in the Father and the Father? That's what he asked Philip. Philip, do you believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? 101. This is critical. Critical. And he says, do you believe this, Philip? Didn't give Philip time to answer. The words that I'm speaking to you, I'm not speaking down here on my own accord. Get this, Philip. Yes, ma'am.
And he eventually did get it.
He eventually did get it.
That's why he was able to
preach over there.
Preach over there.
Yeah. But there's something missing. How come you know, but you coach a little bit, didn't you? Coach? Ball, sports. You ever get a team ready and then they go out there and play and they say, I thought I had them ready.
Oh, yeah.
They got smart. Yeah, whooped. We can say some other things in the locker room, but you know. y'all got to put to you. I mean, I thought we practiced all week. 2 weeks. But we went through training camp, all that stuff. Seemed like y'all just forgot everything. What happened? When you hit on the stage, you hit the big stage and you just flop. This is what Jesus is with them. He's trying to get them not to be there. Now, some of them flop. Peter what? Flop. First step. First chapter. I don't know the guy. He told Peter, you ain't ready. He said, yeah, I'm ready. I'm ready. Test come up. You're going to lie three times, Peter. Peter, nah, I'm going to give my life for you. First test come up, Peter lies, he's out. But Peter wasn't the only one. None of them was ready for the test that Jesus was trying to get them to. Big stage, here we go. So now, verse 11. Believe that I'm in the Father and the what? Else believe me for the very word. Just believe. Look what I was able to do. Check out Lazarus. Go ask him. He'll tell you that I'm somebody. You know. All right. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do what?
Also.
And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to what?
My
Father. And then he tells him, whatever you ask in my Father's name, according to my Father's will and plan, he'll do it. Now, really, to understand how can we understand this, you have to flip through some more chapters here. And here we go. Here we go. John 16. And verse 7. What does it say there?
Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I'll send
him. I'll send him. He says it's absolutely necessary. Why is it absolutely necessary? Because you're going to be stuck where you are. No doubt. I mean, no faith. Forget who I am. Don't know me no more. Can't understand me. Can't explain me to yourself or to anybody else. Don't know who you are. So I got to go away. And if I go away, then the Comforter will come. We know who that Comforter is, the Holy Ghost. Then he'll come to you. But if I stay here, none of y'all get the Holy Ghost. None of y'all understand. None of you will receive the Holy Spirit. And you'll understand that you're going to be always in that baffled state. You're going to practice all you want to. When you get to the big stage, you're going to lose out.
He said, I got a lot of stuff to tell later on. He said, verse 12, I have yet many things to say to you.
Uh-huh.
But you can't bear them.
You can't understand.
You can't understand.
You can't understand. It's quite odd.
When the Spirit of truth comes.
Philip asked him. Philip said, who are you? What show is it? Philip, how could you ask that question? How could you say that? Could it even, those words even come out of your mouth? But Philip is just, it's the best he got.
Mm-hmm.
As Candy pointed out, where is that?
Verse 12.
I have yet many things to say, but you can't understand them now. And that's why, if anybody ever asks you, why do I need the Holy Ghost? Why do I need the Holy Spirit? This is it right here. It says, when he, verse 13, the Spirit of truth is come. He can only come if I depart out of here. When he is come, he will guide you into what? All truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatever he hears, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. You gotta have the Holy Spirit. That's just the folks back in the day when Candy and John start going over here and saying, you can't be saved without the Holy Ghost. You can't be saved without the Holy Ghost. Yeah, you can't have faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior without the infilling of the Holy Ghost. But you cannot get no deep revelation, simple, I'm calling it surface understanding of your Lord and Savior and heaven and all that without the Holy Ghost, because you have nothing imparting information to you, clarifying data that you are receiving. Now you say, no, you're going to receive a lot of data. Since I got saved, I'm going to receive a lot of information.
Yeah.
Jesus only, Seventh Day Adventists, the Pope. Who else? You get a let's go up and down the street. Baptist, Methodist. You got a lot of data out there. Now how can you gonna get it to where you can receive it and work with it and have saving faith? Victorious faith. You don't have a lot of it. Someone asked me yesterday, can you wear pants to your church? So I just want to hear the word. Okay. So there's lots of stuff going on that people, if you don't have the help of the Holy Ghost, you lost it, wasn't it? And he says, if I don't come, and if you don't receive this Holy Ghost, you don't understand this. You all miss it. So, verse 16 of St. John 16, a little while you shall not see me, and again, a little while you shall see me, because I go to who? The Father. Now, there are some events that if we're here saved and we're waiting for Jesus to come back again, that event is called the rapture. 1 Corinthians 15 and the 51st verse. What we are anticipating. Most people who are filled with the Holy Ghost and got good Bible teaching are living anticipating the rapture. 1 Corinthians 15 and I'm going to say, what was that? 51. Okay, here we go. I think you really need to be filled with the Holy Ghost to get a good understanding of this. And what I mean by that, you need the help of the Holy Ghost to help you get this understanding. Because right off the bat, he says what? I'll show you a what?
Mystery.
I'll show you a mystery. You got to figure this out. I'm going to show you a mystery. What's the mystery? We're not going to all die. What? We're not going to all die. We're not going to all be put in a grave down here on the earth. And from childhood up, when you heard it, everybody do it. Everybody, the dirt boy. Ash to ash, dust to dust. Glad this guy is no longer with us. Goes away. But he says, everybody's not going to go through it. I'm showing you a mystery. Now, figure this out. How is this? Well, we shall all be what? Change. So all means all. That means the ones who died and the ones who did not die. Everybody's going to be changed. Huh. How is that going to happen? It says in a moment. It's going to happen so fast. In a moment. How fast is that? Blink. How long does it take to blink? You know? In the twinkling of an eye. Wow. How we know the eye's gonna twink? You hear a trumpet. There's a trumpet. As soon as you hear that trumpet, twink, your eye will blink and it's a change. Last trumpet. The trumpet will sound. The trumpet will sound. Imagine this, all the dead get up walking. can you get this in your spirit and believe it like you believe that Jesus rose up from the dead? Yeah, because he says this is going to happen. This is going to happen. Oh, man. And the dead should be raised, I'm going to say incorruptible, I'm going to say the dead should be raised perfect. Perfect bodies. Perfect. Perfection. It's like baby skin is what? Perfect. Smooth. Baby slobber, you can drink it. Even right now, with 1 year old, we'll tolerate them, you know. But a 30-year-old, no, you ain't drinking out of my glass. What's wrong with you? But hey, man, a little toddler, yeah, he's all right. Perfect slobber. So when we all get raised, everything's perfect.
You could do that backwash.
That backwash is tough, ain't it? But it says they're all going to be perfect. We haven't seen perfection. Man, I'm almost 60 years old. I can't remember the last time I had it all going on. Jump, run, leap, twist, tumble, do it all just at the thought of it. Now it takes some serious, it might be 2 days before I complete that tumble. And then it might be another week before I can walk again. But we all gonna be perfect. You know, kid, they just tumble and fall. And we've been so long, we're so far from perfection, we don't even know. So he said, perfect? I lost my scripture. What was that? 52. Okay. Yeah, we should be raised incorruptible and we shall be changed. You're going to be like the way God made you. Where you want to be. Not close to where he you made in his image. Not like, well, close to.
Like right now.
For this, what? Oh, broke down. This corruptible, decay, got old. What have you, you got to be perfect. There's a clue up there in heaven, perfect, perfection. And then we saw it when Israel came out of Egypt. Not one feeble person among all those people. That was a deliverance.
Wow.
Not one feeble among all those people. So here we go, here it is. We got to get rid of this imperfection, incorruption, and this mortal. We got to get rid of this ability to die and put on the ability to live forever. That's what's going on. So when this corruptible, I put on incorruption, and this mortal, I put on immortality, then we should it should be brought to pass the saying that it is written. What? Death is swallowed up in victory. That's when the last enemy, death, is conquered. Death is swallowed up in victory. Yeah, death is swallowed up in victory. So who's that for? It's for all. Now those that have fallen asleep, those that are still awake. But he said everybody's not going to go to sleep. But everybody will be changed. How can I grasp that? The aid of the Holy Ghost. Help the Lord wants us. You read the scripture. Bring this to me. Make me understand this. Let me see this. Put it in my. Let me see this. What time do we have?
Yes.
Okay. So that's what we have. That's what they miss. And I can't. We cannot understand this. You can't get it in enough lesson time unless you do it over and over. Lots of lessons. The importance of. I can start off in faith. But if I don't have the help, the aid, the assistance of the Holy Ghost, bringing things to my remembrance, clarifying things for me, not just going around praying in tongues, what does that do? That's just, that edifies you. What gives you the ability to explain it to somebody else? Or to have it to yourself, get some understanding. I got a clarity. Because there's so many sounds and billboards and churches in the world, they got some data for you. Yeah, try this, that. Go to the Pope, go to the Cardinal and stick your hand through a window and confess to a man. Just go to church on Saturdays. Pray in Jesus' only name. Why? Trying to get to heaven. This is confusing. What does it take? And Jesus is telling, what did they want to know? What does it take to get to heaven, to go where you're going? What does it take? And he's trying to tell them that it's not all that bad, but y'all ain't got nothing. And Philip, I'm surprised at you. How are you going to ask me a question like that?
Hey,
Philip. Yeah, it was a disappointment to Jesus. But then again, he got filled with the Holy Ghost. You see the word of Philip. That's in Acts chapter 9. After Philip got filled with the Holy Ghost, you see the work of Philip. And then that's where those mansions start getting prepared. Got prepared a place for you. Philip, man, no one is ever. You're the first person to take the gospel to the black man. I think there's a special place in heaven for something like that. He's got a mansion prepared for you. Peter, yeah, you repented. You denied the Lord, but you repented. Look at your word. Look at what you're doing since you got filled with the Holy Ghost and you came to understand. Look at you, man. You're off the charts. There's a special place in heaven. That's got a special spot. It won't be the same spot as Williams got. Williams is not that good. No. I'd probably be a B team, C team player compared to the work that those guys did. You think we got it going on? I don't think so. Some of them gave their life. We weren't even feeling the game. We don't even get into the auditorium, and they say, we might fool ourselves to think we are. I don't think you go down the same street address as Philip.
Well, when the disciples was asking, could we sit on your right hand? I don't think you want to go through what it takes to sit right here.
Can I be your main man up there? Not mine to give you that position up there. but if you earn it, you probably can get it. And that's who gives that earning?
The Father.
The Father take away your glory up there.